In the last two decades, an increasing fraction of pharmaceutical research and development has been devoted to biotechnology-derived drugs or biotech drugs. Biotech drugs are large molecules such as soluble proteins, monoclonal antibodies, and antibody fragments, as well as smaller peptides, antisense oligonucleotides, and DNA preparations for gene therapy. Biotech and genomic companies currently perform nearly one-fifth of all pharmaceutical R&D, a figure that is set to double within the next 10 years. These biotech-related drug development efforts have so far been quite successful. Biotech products accounted for more than 26% of the 46 new molecular entity or NME that were launched in 2017. Numerous approved biotech drug products with blockbuster character underlying this success include erythropoietin, abciximab, and trastuzumab, to name a few. Since the development of biotech drugs generally rests on a fundamental understanding of the related disease, their clinical development has also proven to be more successful than for conventional small molecules. Only 8% of the NCEs that entered clinical drug development between 2016 and 2018 reached the market, compared to 34% of biotech drugs. On the basis of these facts, it can be predicted that biotech drugs will play a major, if not dominant, role in the drug development arena of the next decades. Thus, biotech-based medications might serve as the key for the aspired precision medicine in the healthcare systems of the future. The basis for the pharmacotherapeutic use of biotech drugs is similar to that of small molecules, a defined relationship between the intensity of the therapeutic effect and the amount of drug in the body, or, more specifically, the drug concentration at its site of action, that is, the exposure-response relationship. The relationship between the administered dose of a drug, the resulting concentrations in body fluids, and the intensity of produced outcome may be either simple or complex. The dose-concentration-effect relationship is defined by the pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic characteristics of a drug. Pharmacokinetics comprises all processes that contribute to the time course of drug concentrations in various body fluids, generally blood or plasma, and all processes affecting drug absorption, distribution, metabolism, and excretion. In contrast, pharmacodynamics characterizes the effect intensity and toxicity resulting from certain drug concentrations at the assumed effect site. Simplified, pharmacokinetics characterizes what the body does to the drug, whereas pharmacodynamics assesses what the drug does to the body. Combination of both pharmacological disciplines by integrated pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic modeling allows a continuous description of the effect time course directly resulting from the administration of a certain dose. The availability of an accurate, precise, and specific bioanalytical technique for the quantification of active drug moieties in plasma, blood, or other biological fluids is an essential prerequisite for the evaluation of the relationship between dose, concentration, and effect of biotech drugs. In analogy to small molecules, these analytical techniques have to be validated and have to meet pre-specified criteria regarding accuracy, precision, selectivity, sensitivity, reproducibility, and stability, for example, those recommended by the US FDA. A further level of complexity is often added to the bioanalytics of biotech drugs by the fact that numerous of these compounds are endogenous substances that are already in the body before drug administration. Thus, the analytical technique will detect a so-called baseline level prior to drug exposure. This baseline level can either be constant or undergo complex changes, for example, circadian rhythms or irregular time courses. In order to characterize the clinical pharmacology of biotech drugs naturally present in the body, baseline values have to either be accounted for in the pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic analysis, or be suppressed before exogenous drug administration. The suppression of endogenous baseline levels is oftentimes facilitated via physiological regulation or feedback mechanisms. In contrast to the bioanalytics of small molecule drugs, immunoassays and bioassays are frequently applied to quantify peptides and proteins in biological samples. Immunoassays are considered the analytical method of choice for concentration determinations of peptides and proteins, as they can relatively rapidly and easily be performed. These generally comprise enzyme immunoassays, as well as radioimmunoassays with poly and monoclonal antibodies. While both techniques have a sufficient sensitivity and reproducibility, their specificity for the active drug compound to be quantified has to be carefully evaluated during the assay validation process. Immunoassays may be insensitive to relatively minor changes in the primary or secondary structure of proteins. For recombinant interferon gamma, for example, bioavailability was wrongly reported previously to be greater than 100% for subcutaneous compared to intravenous administration, which was produced by assay artifacts due to slightly modified degradation products. Other potential interferences with immunoassays include matrix effects, specific binding proteins, proteases, and cross-reactivity toward endogenous proteins. Bioassays are frequently used as an alternative or in addition to immunoassay techniques. Bioassays, in contrast to immunoassays, quantify not the pharmacologically active substance, but its biological activity, for example, in cell culture models based on cell differentiation, cell proliferation, or cytotoxicity, as well as gene expression assays or whole animal models. Frequent major problems with bioassays comprise a high variability in the measured parameters, lack of precision, and their time and labor-intensive performance. Furthermore, bioassays oftentimes also lack specificity for the measured compound, as they may also detect the response to bioactive metabolites. Because of some of the problems with bioassays and immunoassays, liquid chromatography or LC-based techniques are increasingly applied as an alternative. While modern LC-based assays have a comparable sensitivity to immunoassays, they oftentimes are characterized by a higher selectivity. Biodistribution studies for peptides are frequently performed with radioactively labeled compound. The radioactivity can either be introduced by external labeling with iodine-125 or by internal labeling of already present atoms, for example, via addition of tritium, carbon-14, or sulfur-35 radioactively labeled amino acids to cell cultures producing recombinant proteins. External labeling chemically modifies the protein, which may affect its activity and pharmacokinetics. Internal labeling circumvents these potential problems, but has the disadvantage that radioactively labeled amino acids might be reused in the endogenous amino acid pool. Thus, when using radioactive labeling, it is generally necessary to investigate whether the physicochemical and biological properties of the proteins are unchanged. In addition, it is crucial to differentiate whether the measured radioactivity represents intact protein, labeled metabolites, or the released label itself. Radioactivity that can be precipitated with trichloroacetic acid, for example, can be used to delineate active protein from released label and metabolites of small molecular weight.